So this is also based on the template by Professor Felder, which I have obtained during one of the teaching workshops. Okay, this, you can actually see whether the students have contributed or not. And then I put them together in this spreadsheet. I use an Excel spreadsheet. Okay, so these are the votes given by each student to their group members. And if you look at the grouping, there will be a Chinese student somewhere, a Malay student. And if I have enough Indians, I will get them in there. And girls and boys, I will mix them together in the group. And I will have a maximum of 5. And you look at this, this is typical. This is what I noticed. The students, they will rate, vote 5 is by Noor Fandi. And he will rate himself quite low. Students are humble sometimes, I notice. Okay, and so when he gets a low rating, he gets a lower grade. So this is the adjustment factor that I obtained from the peer rating by taking the team average divided, by taking the individual average, dividing it by the team average, I obtained the adjustment factor, and that factor I multiply by the marks I give them. This is the mark that I give them. This is the technical content. How they work together is determined by this. Their technical content is determined by me. This is what they tell about each other, how they cooperate in the work. And this is their final grade. Even though they work in a group, their grades are individual grades. So that's how I do my assessment. It's a lot of work. Yes, guys, it's a lot of work. Okay, so what do I do for strengthening my teaching methods? I practice and I get feedback from my students. And I'm a type of person who is constantly thinking about teaching and how to make the process better. The first time I started the cooperative learning, I used a very simple problem. It was the pressure cooker. It was a pressure cooker problem. And then I extended it. The second semester, I extended it to a refrigerator. And then I said, oh my God, everything is in the kitchen. I've got to get away from the house. So and then I went to the power plant. And yes, you try new things at the risk of failure. So far, I haven't. So just to make the students' experience better. And this is what I call as continuous quality improvement. So many things that I've done, e-learning, students' learning portfolio. At the beginning of the class, I would bring boxes and boxes and boxes. And the students would be wondering, what is this lecturer doing? What is she doing with the boxes? And inside the boxes, these boxes are from the Rainbow Stationery. Inside the boxes are those black folders. Okay? And this is what I call learning portfolio. And I give them as a present, each to one of my students. Every one of my students who came to class gets a learning portfolio. You don't come to my class, you don't get a learning portfolio. And then I have one for myself. At the end, after giving up to everybody, there'll be one left. And I say to my student, this is mine. This is my teaching portfolio. This is not the one that I submit to for promotion purposes. For promotion purposes, I have another teaching portfolio. This is the actual teaching portfolio. And going through all these items again, e-learning, I get frustrated when we limit e-learning just for course notes. You upload your course notes, you upload your solution, and you call it a tutorial. How can that possibly be tutorial session if you just put your solutions on in the e-learning? It's just for announcements and for posting of grades so that you get a lot of hitings, you know? At the end of the semester, the TDA will announce the highest hit for e-learning is so-and-so. Congratulations. Well, to me, I think e-learning goes more than that. To me, e-learning is not just that. It's going beyond the classroom. Is going beyond the classroom, meaning I use that as a medium for intellectual discourse for students. For instance, one of my students, Raihana, she asked me, Puan, I was wondering how do people, the Eskimo people, keep their igloo warm? I said, wow, that's a good question. Why don't you post that in the forum, in the e-learning? And she did that. And the others responded. I was amazed because they were saying like, and they were using thermodynamics terms to analyze the igloo. Some were saying, okay, I want to assume the igloo. I want to analyze the igloo as a closed system. And then somebody answered and said, how can you analyze an igloo as a closed system? How the Eskimo is going to get in? So I think you should analyze as an open system. Now, closed system, open system are basic concepts in thermodynamics for your information. So when they said, use it as an open system with a door. And then somebody said, okay, good. But what if the bears goes in? You know? And somebody answered, well, if the bears go in, there'll be a fight and you get more heat in it. You know? So, and then somebody has to put an end to it, right? So I intervene. I say, okay, guys, why don't you do research on this, on this topic? And someone came, yeah, to my delight. Somebody, one of the students came. His name was Muhammad Hilmi. He said that, I found this on the internet. I found a website that actually describes how the igloo. It explains to you the physics being how the igloo is kept warm. You know, so he gave the website the address and all, and that was the end of the discussion. So that's when I say going beyond the classroom. Okay. And also I use it as a form of feedback because students were right in the e-learning about questions they want to ask but didn't have time to ask in the class. So I did that. And as I mentioned earlier, this is the learning portfolio that I gave to the students because I believe that a lot of time, the students are being told, you must manage your time properly, time management. Yeah? But does anyone ever tell them that you need to also manage your material correctly? So I let them keep everything so that they don't have to ask me, when is that first test one? It's in your learning portfolio. Everything is there. So if they have no access to the internet for their e-learning, they have another option, which is their learning portfolio. If they don't have information about the course, they cannot have access to the internet. A backup is the learning portfolio. They have everything in there. So, and I have my own report card and my portfolio, it's called the teaching portfolio. It is my report card. I have everything in here, all my teaching plans. Yeah? I have my entry survey. I have my students' photos because I have to remember my students' name. I have to devise a way to remember my students' name. If I have 60 students in my class, I remember at least 40. Okay? So studio guide, videotaping, these are all in my actual teaching portfolio. This is an example of an entry survey. I need to know their name. Confidential here, okay? So their telephone number, their email address, where they're from, and this is their family background. You know why I asked for the family background? He says here, I'm from a poor family. My father is sick. My mother worked as a housekeeper. The reason why I have that, because I have this program in my class. Every semester, I give away three textbooks for my students. I call that the free textbook program. Textbook loan program, not free. Textbook loan program. So that from this is where I identify the potential candidates for my program. And I call them to my room. Don't announce it to anyone. One-to-one, call them and I say, look, I have a textbook.